and Jeff Davis, the All-America linebacker. They'll come up with a four-man rush. Time for one, possibly two plays. 6 seconds left. Maurer back to throw under pressure. Throwing the bomb down the far side. That pass is going to be batted down, and this football game is over.
Victory in the Orange Bowl was the culmination of Clemson's season-long climb to the pinnacle of college football. During the sport's most unpredictable year, no fewer than six teams fell victim to the number one jinx. The last to arrive at that spot, only the Tigers emerged unbeaten from the long campaign and thus assumed their rightful place at the top. Inexplicably, Clemson had been overlooked in the preseason polls, but in retrospect, it was obvious that they possessed all the ingredients for greatness. A wealth of battle-hardened veterans returned from the previous year and were joined by a crop of promising freshmen headed by massive nose guard William Perry. The Tigers had a dedicated and hard-driving head coach in young Danny Ford, who had learned the game from the master, the legendary Paul Bear Bryant of Alabama. Against Georgia, college football's best-kept secret burst into the open. An unforgiving Clemson defense stopped All-American Herschel Walker and the defending national champions 13-3, and the Tigers broke into the top 20 for the first time. From there, the Tigers boarded the Orange Bowl special, leaving a trail of battered victims in their wake and climbing inexorably in the polls. A showdown win over North Carolina and a methodical victory over Maryland clinched the ACC title and boosted Clemson to the number two spot as the season wound down. Then, after Penn State tumbled Pitt from the ranks of the unbeaten in late November, the Tigers found themselves alone at number one. By knocking off number four Nebraska on New Year's night, Clemson laid indisputable claim to the championship and guaranteed that 1981 would forever be remembered as the year of the Tiger. Danny Ford became the youngest coach in history to win the national championship. In an interview in our studios, we asked him about the preparation for the 81 campaign and the keys to Clemson's success.
Our football season got off to a good start, but back during July, we had a good planning session. Our coaches went on and planned the season. We decided we were going to have a plan for the season and stick with it no matter what happened. We talked a lot about senior leadership on our football team. Our football team the year before was embarrassed because they were 6-5, and the seniors coming up wanted to have a better football team. The improvement of our quarterback, Homer Jordan, was tremendous, and I think that was a big part of it. Our defensive football team became a good defensive football team again, and the year before we wasn't quite a good defensive football team. But we think that the dedication of our people, the courage that they displayed, the staying healthy, not getting hurt, and keeping everybody well for our football team during the whole year. We lost two youngsters with injuries for the whole year, and that's rather remarkable when you only lose two people for the whole year.
The Tigers opened the season by routing Wofford at home and surviving the green wave of Tulane in the Superdome. Then defending titleist Georgia and peerless runner Herschel Walker came into Death Valley, bringing with them the nation's longest winning streak, a number four national ranking, and a reputation for invincibility. Unawed, the Tigers had prepared a few surprises for the invaders from Athens. When they came out clad head to toe in a brilliant orange, the partisan crowd of 64,000 exploded in a deafening roar, a pitch they maintained throughout the contest. Ignoring the crowd and the Clemson defense, the Bulldogs mounted a drive on their second possession with the incomparable Walker keying the assault. They marched steadily to the Clemson 24. On first down, Herschel had it left into a mass of Clemson defenders, who forced him to fumble, and backup safety Jeff Suttle recovered to end the Georgia penetration. Walker's uncharacteristic misplay was just the beginning of the Bulldogs' afternoon of frustration. In all, they committed the unpardonable total of 9 turnovers, some of their own making, the others caused by the inspired Clemson defense. Had it not been for the equally superb play of the Bulldog defense, the game may well have turned into a Clemson rout. The Tigers converted the 4th Georgia error into the afternoon's only touchdown midway through the second quarter. Under pressure, Georgia quarterback Buck Ballou had his pass picked off by strong safety Tim Childers, giving Clemson possession deep in Bulldog territory. A Homer Jordan keeper off left tackle netted a first down on the Georgia 8. On the next play, Jordan spotted All-American Perry Tuttle in the right-hand corner of the end zone. And Tuttle lived up to his billing with a diving circus catch. Pauling's point after was true, and the Tigers led 7-0. Later in the period, they added to their lead by capitalizing on another Walker bobble. With 11 seconds left, Nigerian import Donald Igwe-Biwike booted a 39-yard field goal for a 10-point halftime cushion. Except for Kevin Butler's 40-yard three-pointer, the Bulldogs' misfortunes continued in the second half. When they weren't stopping themselves with untimely turnovers, the Tiger defense was shutting off their normally high-powered attack, twice throwing Walker back on crucial third and short situations. In the end, the difference was spelled with a capital D for defense. The Bulldogs were held to just 256 yards of total offense, while Walker managed only 111 yards rushing, his lowest output of the season. Coach Ford comments on Clemson's winning strategy.
Of course, Georgia was coming off the national championship from the year before. They had the longest winning streak in the nation, and very similar type situation. We're going into Athens this year with the defending national championship and the longest winning streak in the nation. But I think our preparation was excellent for our football game against the University of Georgia, and our people played very well, carried out a game plan, and executed it very well. But I don't think you ever stop a outstanding back like Herschel Walker. You try to hold him down to the minimum amount of yardage you can, and he's going to get his amount every ball game because he's such a great back. They got great personnel at the University of Georgia. They may not have had their best football game that day when they played against us. They had a lot of turnovers, but you got to say that Clemson caused some of those turnovers. There were 9 turnovers in the football game against the University of Georgia, and our people just played exceptionally well on defense. They played good field position football. They scored enough points to win the football game. Great ball game for our people and a tough one for Georgia, and I know that going in to Sanford Stadium this fall and playing in a first night game in a long time down there, it'll be a tremendous football game.
Armed with growing confidence and a number 18 ranking, the Tigers journeyed to Lexington, Kentucky for a regionally televised encounter with a fired up Wildcats. Behind by a field goal, the Clemson offensive line began to assert itself. And open terrain seemed to greet their runners on nearly every catch. Mack's 11-yard burst capped an 83-yard march early in the third quarter, and the remainder of Clemson's 21 second-half points came on 3-yard runs by Jordan and tailback Chuck McSwain. A spate of upsets across the country propelled the Tigers into the top 10. And they returned home to Tiger Town to open their ACC schedule against hapless Virginia. No Cavalier team had ever beaten Clemson in 20 seasons of triumph, and today would not be an exception. Entering the contest as the nation's stingiest unit, the Tiger defenders completely shut down the Virginia attack and the offense got all the points it needed on Cliff Austin's long scamper in the second quarter. The Tigers added two Igwe-Bewike field goals and two short touchdown runs by Austin and Jeff McCall for a 27-0 win, their fifth of the season. The offense exploded the following week in a 38-10 rout of Duke in Wallace Wade Stadium, with Austin collecting a career-high total of 178 yards and Jordan passing for nearly 200 more. The Tigers amassed over 560 yards in total offense. Meanwhile, the Clemson defense was performing at its standard level of proficiency, stopping the Blue Devils on six successive plays at the Tiger one. The impressive dismantling of Duke moved Clemson to fourth place in the writers and fifth place in the coaches' poll. The next Saturday was Jeff Davis Day in Death Valley, called the judge by his teammates. The senior All-American linebacker presided over a 17-7 verdict over North Carolina State. Davis handcuffed the Wolfpack attack, single-handedly accounting for 15 tackles and personally producing nearly 20 yards in losses. That kind of performance was clearly in order, because the Tiger offense was suffering through a subpar afternoon. Off the mark with his passing, Jordan went overland for a career-high total of 104 yards on 21 carries, and he expertly directed two long scoring drives. The Tigers locked up their seventh straight win when McCall broke off a block by All-American tackle Lee Nanny for a 15-yard touchdown in the fourth quarter. The game was an excellent demonstration of Jordan's versatility. Coach Ford.
Of course, Homer was a quarterback only 1 year in high school, and then we played him as quarterback as a freshman, and coming into the spring training of his sophomore year, we were going to move him to defensive back, so... He was very limited on experience at quarterback. He needed some leadership abilities, which he had, but he just needed some experience to get. And after that first season, which he suffered through about half the season before he started really improving, and from about half the season when we were 6-5, he improved steadily, and then he came up with a great, great junior year. We look for great things for Homer Jordan this his senior year. He is truly an outstanding youngster and with outstanding ability and leadership.
If there were any doubts about the Clemson offense, they were permanently dispelled the next week against overmatched Wake Forest. The Tigers buried the Deacons under an orange blizzard, scoring virtually at will and by almost every conceivable means. When it mercifully ended, the Tigers had scored an unbelievable 82 points, had broken 10 school and 4 conference records, and had shredded the poorest Deacon defense for more than 750 yards in total offense. The Tigers now occupied the number 2 spot in the polls, and their fans began to ponder the impossible dream: a holiday trip to Miami and a shot at the national title. What were the elements that produced the Tigers' 1981 success? Obviously, they had superior talent and coaching, but there were at least two other factors that contributed. One, the unwavering loyalty of Clemson's many boosters, and two, perhaps the best conditioning program in college athletics. Coach Ford comments.
Well, we have an organization here called IPTE, and they will raise over $4 million this year for scholarship money, and they'll cover 19 sports, and our scholarship situation here at Clemson is probably the best in the country. We have the number one fans, in our opinions. They will go and they will support their football team, win, lose, or draw, and they're very proud of it, and those are the people that we really and truly care about being around, those kind of fans.
The foundation for the championship season was laid here in this room, the Clemson Strength Training Facility, considered by many to be the finest of its type in the country. The program is designed and directed by Dr. George Dostal, who was named Strength Coach of the Year.
Way in the back of this facility, we have our free weight area, which we do explosive power movements back there and get all of our strength, heavy strength work done. We come into the section that we're standing in now, which is our Nautilus area. That's our flexibility, what we call our flexibility strength area. And then up to the front of the facility, we have a CAM2 section, which works on the light muscle fiber or fast twitch, which works on our quickness. So our whole foundation theory about strength training, therefore, is built on these three basic premises, plus a lot of gadgets and a lot of different things that we do for special work. We have a sandbox back there that we squeeze sand to make our players have better grip, so they've just now had a new rule change that taken away the tearaway jerseys, so we have to get our hands stronger so we can just pull people down with by grabbing a hold of the jersey and that type of thing. So it's a whole total concept. We want to be stronger, more explosive power. We want to be have good flexibility strength, and we want to work on our quickness when we're a little bit tired. So that's our whole premise.
Riding an 8-game winning streak and holding the second spot in the polls, the Tigers travel to Chapel Hill's Keenan Stadium for the regionally televised showdown with 9th-ranked North Carolina. It was the first time in history that two ACC schools had met while both were in the top 10. The contest was billed as a matchup between two prolific offenses, but it turned into a fearsome defensive struggle. After a scoreless first quarter, injured quarterback Rod Elkins promptly led his team to the Tiger set. As it had done all season, the Tiger defense rose to the occasion, and the Tar Heels had to settle for a Brooks-Barwick field goal and a 3-point lead. The Tigers responded by staging an 81-yard, 15-play march on their next possession. Though most of the yardage came on the ground, the key play of the drive occurred on 3rd and 5 at the Carolina 39, when Jordan hit Tuttle over the middle for a 16-yard gain. From there, the Tigers pounded it in, with McCall following Nanny for the final 7 yards and the score. The Tigers launched another ground attack after intermission, but had to settle for an Igwe Buike field goal when they stalled at the UNC 23. The Tar Heels answered with a long drive of their own to a first down on the Tiger 4. Once more, the proud orange line stiffened. Davis diagnosed a sweep to the right, dumped all-conference Kelvin Bryant for a 5-yard loss, and forced a second Barwick field goal. Just over 2 minutes remained when Hatcher putted out of bounds at the 2, and a Clemson victory seemed assured. But the Tar Heels refused to concede. With Elkins disabled on the bench, sophomore Scott Stankavage hastily directed an 11th-hour march. Poised against destiny, the Clemson defense dug in for one final challenge.
Stankavage drops back. He tosses it to Burris on the right, but it pops out of his hands. Bill Smith takes Burris out of the play, but that ball's still loose. Jeff Bryant falls out after the Tigers. But is it a fumble? If it's ruled a lateral, Clemson will get the ball, and that'll clinch a 10-8 win.
Now, only Maryland stood between the Tigers and the conference title, and they achieved that objective in Death Valley with a convincing 21-7 triumph. Denied the run by the famed wide tackle 6, Jordan exploited the vulnerable Terp secondary with the most impressive aerial performance of his career. For the afternoon, he completed 20 of 29 passes for 270 yards and 3 first-half touchdowns, including 2 to favorite target Perry Tuttle. showing the form that made him a first-round draft choice of the Buffalo Bills, Tuttle finished with 10 receptions for 161 yards. After Jordan connected with Jerry Galliard for a third score late in the second quarter, the Tigers turned matters over to the defense to preserve their 10th win. An unbeaten season, a trip to the Orange Bowl, and a shot at the national championship hung in the balance when the Tigers took on arch-rival South Carolina the next week in Columbia. In the early going, Clemson bore little resemblance to the nation's second-ranked team, as Johnny Wright's one-yard plunge gave the Gamecocks a seven-point lead. Stunned, the Tigers quickly reverted to form. And typically, it was the defensive unit that provided the spark. Rod McSwain broke through to block a punt, and reserve linebacker Rembert recovered in the end zone. Midway through the second quarter, all-conference Hollis Hall intercepted a Gordon Beckham pass and returned it to the Carolina 28. Four plays later, Jordan skirted right end for 11 yards and a 15-7 halftime lead. Chuck McSwain furnished both second-half touchdowns, first powering over from the one, then breaking up the middle from the 23. The 29-13 victory wrapped up the school's first 11-0 season since Frank Howard's 1948 squad, and it assured them of the number one ranking after Penn State toppled previously unbeaten Pittsburgh the following week.
Our people were very excited about going to the Orange Bowl, and it was a big football game for Clemson, for the state of South Carolina, and for the ACC Conference. And there were so many things that happened in that football game that, first of all, people didn't know how good Clemson was. I think even though they were rated number one in the country at that time, we were four-point underdog going into the football game, and Nebraska from the Big Eight was expected to win the football game. Our youngsters took a great amount of pride in the football game. I think they played the hardest football game they've ever played, probably the best football game they've ever played. We played tremendous defense for 45 minutes and let them get off at the end, made a pretty good football game out of it, but our offense moved the football late in the ball game, kept control of the football, and won probably as big a football game as ever been won at Clemson University, and our coaches and our players and our fans, it was a tremendous honor for us to be associated with them and our players. It was great to see them get the recognition which they deserved all season.
Then he was on to Miami and a date with number four Nebraska, and over 40,000 Clemson boosters gave the occasion an added orange flavor. Not surprisingly, the Tigers called upon the mystique of their orange pants, in which they had never tasted defeat. The defense contained the vaunted Cornhusker attack for most of the evening and forced two first-half turnovers that supplied scoring opportunities for the struggling offensive unit. The first occurred in the game's second minute when linebacker Danny Triplett manhandled quarterback Mark Maurer on an attempted pitch-out, and Devan recovered at the Husker 28. Unable to move closer, the Tigers called on Igwe Buike for a 41-yard field goal. The aroused Huskers came right back with a 69-yard, 8-play drive that ended on halfback Mike Rozier's 25-yard strike to Anthony Steele. After Igwe Buike cut the margin to one, the judge pounced on a Phil Bates fumble at the Nebraska 27. Clemson needed 8 plays before Austin took a pitch from Jordan for the final 2 yards. Leading 12-7, Jordan fashioned a precision 75-yard scoring march, sandwiching first down tosses to Tuttle between runs by McCall and McSwain. On third and goal at the 13, Tuttle found himself in man coverage and beat defender Alan Lydie in the left-hand corner of the end zone. Pauling's point after was true, and the Tigers led 19-7 with 6:12 left in the third quarter. 1 minute later, Nebraska was forced to punt, and Bill Davis broke off the right side for a twisting 47-yard run to the Huskers' 22. That set up Igwe Buike's third field goal of the night, and this one from the 27. The Cornhuskers were not about to fold, however. On first down at the 26, Roger Craig eluded a Clemson defender and raced untouched down the left sideline. After a 50-yard hatcher punt, the Huskers took over at the 37 for a crucial series of downs. The Tigers survived the threat when tackle Dan Benish wrapped up Mauer on third down, and Nebraska had to punt with 5:24 remaining. On third and four, Jordan produced the game's decisive play. Calling his own number, he turned the right corner, cut back over the middle, and scurried 23 yards for another first down. Now, time was an ally, and the Tigers consumed all but 6 seconds, hardly enough for a Nebraska miracle.
Time for one, possibly two plays. 6 seconds left. Mauer back to throw under pressure, throwing the bomb down the far side. That pass is going to be batted down, and this football game is over, and Clemson's going to be the national champion.
The next day's polls confirmed what Tiger Town already knew. Unbeaten Clemson reigned supreme at the summit of college football.